honored and excited as I stand in this holy ground. This is an historic place for the Catholic Church, the Mother Church of the Catholics in England and Wales. After centuries of persecution, Catholic journey started here again. This church is a poem in stone. History is embedded in these walls. I am deeply humbled by the thought that in this same cathedral, two great popes, St. John Paul II and Benedict XVI, said Mass. Thank you very much for the warm welcome. Like the old past history of alienation, I do come from a country where a totalitarian regime is squeezed the human spirit mercilessly through a vicious and heartless dictatorship. Being a Christian was a risk in those days. As a nation and as a Catholic, I stand here with a heavy debt of gratitude to the Catholic Church, the civil society, and the government for the support rendered to the people of Myanmar. Through advocacy and international campaign, you stood by us in our darkest hour. Today, democracy has its dawn. Myanmar is an island of hope in the world and has its chosen brothership. A fragile woman will hold not only power in our hands, but the dreams of the millions for a better tomorrow. I'm here on a mission to UK, on a mission to talk about our people, especially those excluded. To be a Christian today is not an easy task. First reading, Paul was a broken Sanhedrin. The message of Christ was so challenging, the status quo. The simple message of love shook the foundations of even those days. The first Christians entered in as martyrs. Today, in the 54 countries in the world, Christians live under threat to their life and dignity. I belong to a church that underwent and owns its own order of suffering during the dictatorship. I wish to pray for all those who are persecuted for their religion. More than ever, we are called upon to bear witnesses, as St. Paul was introduced, instructed by the Lord. Bear witness to what? The second reading gives a succinct answer, that they may be one. But who are these all may be one? In this very cathedral, historic attempts were made to bring Christians of all views together. It is a relevant argument to ask this question: who are these all may be one? That starts a long march of the ideal of redemption. Jesus today brings a great idea: as I in you, and you in me. Man's quest for dignity and divinity starts in the first pages of the Bible. Men and women, says the Bible, are created in the image of God. St. Paul will say that you are the temple of the Holy Spirit. The worth of human beings, infinite according to the Christian tradition. Today, Jesus prays that all may be in us, as the Jesus is in the Father, and the Father in Jesus. Christianity's contribution to this world is this extraordinary perception of the human dignity. Unity of the human family, diversity, dignity in the diversity. These are the messages of the modern world. that the design of God is challenged by an uncaring world. Are we united as a human family? No, says the Pope, two major challenges, environmental injustice and economic injustice, has fragmented this world dangerously, threatening our very existence as humans. The prayer that all may be one has again an urgency under this hope. All is equated with those who are marginalized by a heartless march of economy that benefits a few. That the all is equated with the victims of environmental injustice. Millions stand outside the benefits of science and the economy today. So the prayer rises strongly today that all may be one. Liberty is excluded. I wish to reflect further a bit based on my country, Burma, Myanmar. We sail through the Easter season, the season of hope. We move towards Ascension and now Pentecost, great feast. I wish to talk about the Burma. I wish to formulate my reflection on the way of the cross, our past. The Easter, our present, and finally, Pentecostal season, hope for a better future. I'm sure as a Christian community, my thoughts will resonate with you all as we confront the challenges of the world. First of all, the Good Friday feast. Salvam Dukka. Every day we are suffering, says Buddha. But our country was taken to 5 decades of Calvary by evil men. Everyone thought this was a country without an Easter. You have witnessed from far the suffering of the nation. Those times many countries did not wear the way of the cross. There was a iron curtain, and our country was under what we call a wood curtain. We were one of the richest and highly educated nation in the 50s and 60s. But by a miracle, we were reduced to one of the poorest nations on earth. Even today, we remain the second poorest nation, next only to Afghanistan. Our Calvary was marked by enforced starvation, denied education to the youth, arrest and imprisonment thousands of those asking for basic rights, death and the disappearance of thousands. The country closed itself. Catholic Church was singled out for persecution. Overnight, missionaries serving the poor and the vulnerable were expelled. Lands, schools, medical institutions were confiscated. It was not the church that was victimized, but it was the poor of the country who were victimized. Thousands were left without space to survive. Nearly 1 million became refugees and IDPs. Christians bore greater fortitude than this agony. Most of the Christians came from ethnic groups, and the dictators had a special treatment for people who chose Christianity. Propagation of religion was banned, new churches could not be built, church personnel had to be sent out of the country steadily for any training. In many places, being a Christian was the greatest liability. Many Christians had to hide under a dervish name, yet no public employment had been given to the Christians. Christians in the army were discriminated. The language and cultural rights of our people were taken away by the one language, one race, one religion policy. The natural resources found mostly in the ethnic Christian areas were looted. War raged between the ethnic armies and the government forces regularly displacing. That became a major trade. Myanmar is the second biggest producer of opium in the world. and exported to Afghanistan. Trafficking of women and girls is another off the chart of this age. Yes, those were the years of January. Our land was not 40 days, but 365 days. The way of the cross was for 50 long years. The second phase, Easter phase, God did not abandon our nation. The church was like a mustard seed, like a biblical example, it grows into a tree. Like the Pharisees and the Roman Empire, I dreamt that with the death of Jesus, this dream of kingdom of God would be buried. Our rulers too miscalculated the resilience of the church. We were like the persecuted first Christians. The odds were against them. Yet Paul would cry out, what then shall we say in response to these things? If God is for us, who can be against us? And history persecuted churches know the presence of God intensely. It was our grace to be wounded that our healer was God. Is one of the most suffering oppressions the church grew. It was the carpenter's son who proved to be a great challenge to the Roman imperialism 2,000 years ago. Without an army, without a sword, Christ's words shook evil. The power of empty hands. In every age, the power of empty hands change history. Myanmar's rise from tombs of despair was not effected by UN, not the world powers and armies, but by the moral power of a fragile woman, Aung San Suu Kyi. Her moral courage shook one of the arrogant armies in the world. With her silence, with her redemptive suffering as a prisoner, she melted decades of oppression. A democracy is born in this nation. Myanmar is proud that its Easter movement came in its most peaceful manner through a woman whose belief in peace and non-violence stand in stark contrast to the violent conflicts in many parts of the world. It is a great inspiration that peace is possible and moral power can overcome all human suffering. We do have a Pope who brings this great power of the empty hands. His words have changed the way of the world. The world has looked at economic justice and environmental justice. Yes, this is an Easter season for the world. Despite the bad news in the Middle East, the world is waking up to a new dawn. I would not like to extend my homily. The third one is the Pentecost phase. Pentecost empowers. Pentecost proclaims the good news. Pentecost heals. Pentecost makes people to speak a new tongue. Pentecost brings many miracles. I wish to end with this thought. Religions can be a great source of peace and prosperity. In Myanmar, church wishes to include everyone in the sacred pilgrimage of the human dignity. In this, as we are praying for each one of you, especially for the work of this